You know, when I look back, of all the political experiments throughout history, democracy is the one that has come closest to distributing power to ordinary people, to protection of individuals and minorities from the oppression, from the repression of governments. It has, in combination with capitalism, brought astonishing levels of prosperity. So it's a surprise to me, it's even a shock, to see that democracy is in trouble, not only in the West, but in all regions of the world. More specifically, what's called liberal democracy, meaning not just voting, but also including individual rights and limitations on power. This raises all sorts of questions. Democracy is important enough for us all to ask those questions and insist on answers. For example, why had income inequality risen to such disturbing levels? Does the concentration of wealth threaten democracy itself? Are we seeing the return of a more radical right based on ethnic nationalism with xenophobia and racism thrown into the mix? Is there a renewed desire for strong authoritarian leaders willing to trample on the rights of all people in order to lead them to some sort of a brighter future? We decided to travel to Europe, the heart of the democratic experiment, to find out what has caused this democratic distemper, this malaise with democracy. Where is it today, and where is it likely to go tomorrow? Would have been East Berlin 25 years ago. In fact, the Brandenburg Gate was part of the wall that separated East from the West.
On the Sunday morning of August 13th, 1961, groups of East German workers and soldiers began digging up roadways and putting up barriers across the 193 streets that linked the Russian sector with the three Western ones.
An iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Budapest. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere.
It separated communism from capitalism, authoritarianism from democracy.
They were murderers. All of them were murderers.
I was a child of the Hungarian Revolution.
56.
56. And I do remember the tanks rolling in, and also the following summer, two plainclothes took my father away and had to serve 1.5 years in jail.
Like the gangster story in a way, but it was much, 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 much more boring. Yeah? And so I was more a dictatorship of very mediocre people. And they're afraid for everything.
In 1987, we had the 750th anniversary of the city of Berlin. Part of that was a concert for Berlin, 3 day long, 60,000 people. Actually, right behind the Reichstag, 20 meters behind this building, was the wall. The people came to the Brandenburg Gate, East Berliners, and they just wanted to have a party. And what made them crazy and upset was the reaction of the East German police, because they were beating them up.
You must read the Stasi declaration of what a negative youth is. This is the haircut. It's about not polite against authorities. It's about Western music. It's all what young people are doing was negative for the Stasi.
Rock and roll is Freiheit.
Oh.
So we had a confrontation between the soldiers, the border guards, the East German police, and these young people. So they started to shout, tear down the wall. And this was actually, this is what other people told me, the first time that this happened.
And then in 1989, East Berliners came down here and tore down this wall with their own hands and hammers.
The energy was so strong, the longing for freedom from the majority of the people was so strong, it really swept away the dictatorship. That's why they give up, you know, they just give up. I mean, there was nothing. Millions of people on the street.
And along with it, the entire Soviet empire came tumbling down.
Democracy was recognized as the best way, best political organization of the present world.
So here we are, starting our journey in Berlin to take stock of the last 25 years and find out whatever happened to the promise of prosperity, unity, and democracy in Europe.
It was former East, former West.
This street. Which now looks very civilized. It was, of course, the place where the wall, people were shot here, the houses were ruined.
Was the optimism misplaced? Was it well placed? Was it a turning point in history? Was it a break in history?
The falling of the wall was both a turning point in history, a sea change, and at the same time, it was part of a much longer process which has not yet come to a new steady state.
One can say 25 years is not the time span you can find ultimate judgment. We have to wait.
But what won? Was it democracy over dictatorship, or was it capitalism over communism, or both?
I think it was capitalism over socialism, yes.
And do you think today democracy should be judged also by economic performance?
Democracy and poverty is not, in the long run, is not good enough.
What happened in 1989, was it reversible?
No, it's not reversible.
No.
No, no. In no case a reversal.
I see decreasing percentages of participants in elections.
That can be a good sign. If people are very excited, they go to the polls in very large numbers. In Germany, you had 92% participation. Now we have something between 60 and 70%.
That's 50% less.
Well, thank God. Yeah. Thank God for that. People are not so excited. They are not so militant.
You think they're not so excited because the system is going well? Is that what you suggest?
The system is
so they don't need to go in and vote?
Absolutely. There's not so much protest.
But there's another explanation, Professor. Their strategic policy is being decided in Washington. Their standards are being decided in Brussels Commission. Their foreign policy decided in France. Their economic policy is decided and interest rates decided by the German Central Bank.
Not all Germans believe in God, but they all believe in the Bundesbank. They decide on interest rates, very important decisions, much more important than the school next door or the road to the next village.
But for many Europeans, and as well as East Europeans, it just doesn't feel like this is the promised democracy, where I elect and I get results.
The West Germans voice said, you don't have to pay. The East Germans said, you will have flowering landscapes within 2 years. And
five years.
But democracy works as long as it offers the possibility to change political elites, to change governments.
To ensure mobility
and,
in the system.
Yeah.
And don't forget, democracy is about governance. Now, I would say grow up and understand that you are responsible for yourself.
But you seem to be disappointed with people's disappointment.
People often, especially young people, have an overblown idea of what democracy is for. They don't think about governance, they think about happiness, which is a very dangerous thing because the complete welfare state takes away your personal responsibility. In a way, you are infantilized.
But it provides you with equal opportunity.
Equal opportunity is fully accepted, but it doesn't mean egalitarianism.
No.
Once you have your equal opportunity, some are faster than others, some are more effective than others. You cannot stop a country like Germany, which has a better infrastructure than most of our neighbors.
But that's the problem. It's no longer between countries. These are members of the same union. Other forms
don't go
of...
over the top. The European Union is a union of individual states. We have a transfer union, yes.
More and more people learn that they are not alone in this world. Germans could learn to find ways of solidarity which will not reduce the German performance, but which will reduce tensions within Europe.
When I was in Greece and when I was in other countries just recently, what I heard was, you know, we are tired of Germans dictating to us.
And not tired of getting our money. Yeah. No, this is a different thing.
That in financial crises, it takes two to make a solution. The debtor can't make the solution by itself. If the creditor is smart, like we were vis-a-vis Poland, the debtor gets a fresh start. If the creditor is vindictive, like we were vis-a-vis Russia, you end up with crisis. If the creditor is just not thinking clearly, like Germany vis-a-vis Greece, you end up with this prolonged crisis and what is, in fact, at the magnitude of a Great Depression.
As you said before, the people don't decide about banking system, about bonds and so on. Yeah?
Which doesn't bode well for democracy.
If you look at the German history after 1945, you'll find that the people started to trust democratic institutions as soon as the economic progress was for them visible.
And grumbling, a good bit of grumbling is part of freedom and democracy. The thing is, what we are aiming at is, of course, is the future of the world defined in terms of liberal, Western-type democracy, or is the future of the world defined in terms of Chinese model with a bit of Russia mixed in? That will be decided by the economic success.
That will be decided by the economic success.
I think so, yes.
What happened to that optimism?
It was an illusion.
Maybe we were naive.
It was a kind of naive.
But we speak about triumph is always an illusion.
The glorious transition to the end of history fell apart in Russia. Speculators and insiders became instant billionaires. Gangsters were bankers who became oligarchs, while poverty and disease ravaged the country. Until Vladimir Putin, with his KGB friends, stepped in and reasserted the power of the state. Yes, Putin was elected, and the world shook his hand and agreed that Russia was a democracy. But democracy had come to mean a combination of power of the people through voting, plus the rule of law, free speech, a free press, and the ability to have genuine political competition without getting beaten, jailed, or assassinated for your trouble. Now our political supermarkets have two kinds on sale. The old one is called liberal democracy, while the new is called illiberal democracy. Because that sounds better than the you can vote, but you won't exactly have full rights democracy. Nobody thought illiberal democracy would be a hot product. Yet in 2010, the Hungarians elected the Fidesz party, which would promise exactly that.
We have won.
The new state that we are constructing in Hungary is an illiberal state, a non-liberal state.
Hey.
You don't believe that democracy triumphed?
Triumph is a bad word. Democracy was recognized as the best way, best political organization of the present world.
Of the present, not the end of history.
No, no. End of history, there is no such a thing as end of history. History, in fact, never ends.
Hungary and other countries in Eastern Europe joined the European Union. What happened to that?
I think it is still valid. I think we feel at home in the European Union. The question today is not whether we want to belong to the European Union or not, but what is the future of the European Union as a democratic political union?
But your leader here in Hungary says, Putin is my guy, not Merkel.
He wants to look at it as a role model, how to organize the state.
And
it's absolutely terrifying. I do agree with that.
No, but that's what's troubling. So
this government has always to fight against somebody and something. So they do not admit the failures of the government, but then they say that, okay, who we have to blame for the mistakes, it is liberalism. It's absolutely nonsense. It has got a very clear function. He has to motivate his own voters, Mr. Orban, and this is what he does.
But he's doing more than motivating voters. He is changing the constitution. He is changing the way the system works.
What happened here is a constitutional coup. Everything was formally, legally okay. They passed with their two-thirds majority a new constitution. But in fact, they occupied all the institutions, from the Constitutional Court to the Supreme Court, the media, and in fact, all positions with newly appointed loyal guys on top of them.
Constitutional
So we
coup.
Have... yes, exactly.
And you think that's paving the way towards authoritarianism in Hungary?
This is the way. We are on this way.
We are on this way.
This is already an authoritarian system.
Hungarian democracy at large is at stake. There are issues about the Constitutional Court and its independency. There are issues about the independencies of justice. There is a lot of questionable problems about the independency of media. Yeah, and the Orban regime is very close to sort of no longer really democratic structures.
Liberalism is definitely one of the ingredients of the democratic state.
Just because a state is not liberal, it can still be a democracy.
No modern democracy which is not liberal cannot be a modern democracy, because then the minority, whether it's ethnic or religious or tribal minority, they won't have the possibility to defend their rights because they won't have any rights whatsoever.
The starting point of the liberal organization of society is based on the idea that we have the right to do anything that does not infringe on the freedom of the other party.
It assures the liberty of individuals, of groups of individuals, freedom of expression.
It is unclear who is going to decide the limits beyond which someone is infringing on our freedom. What we experienced continuously in everyday life was that the strongest decided. What we continuously experienced was the weak were trampled over.
Comrade Stalin said that he defends democracies against the Western countries. If you look at Mussolini's talk about liberalism, he said liberalism is a dead dog. It's over.
The liberal democracy was incapable of serving the interest of the nation. It also failed to prevent families from falling into debt slavery.
Orban perhaps did not even know that liberal democracy is a slogan first formulated by Lenin and then by Mussolini. What they reject is liberalism. Always liberalism is the enemy. So that is playing with fire.
In the great global race that is underway to create the most competitive state, Hungary's citizens are expecting Hungary's leaders to find, formulate, and forge a new method of Hungarian state organization that, following the liberal state and the era of liberal democracy, and while of course respecting the values of Christianity, freedom, and human rights.
Thank you.
following the liberal state and the era of liberal democracy, and while of course respecting the values of Christianity, freedom, and human rights, can again make the Hungarian community competitive.
Is that why we hear more and more Hungary first or Hungary for the Hungarians? What does that mean?
Hungary, that's a nationalist slogan.
You think Hungary is an exception or it's going to be a model?
No, I wouldn't say it's a model. What's happening, I think, is quite relevant in whole Europe. Like, just look at France, look at Greece. I think in post-crisis eras, it's absolutely natural that people seek for nationalistic rhetoric as well.
We were outside in the country and we saw some Romas. And clearly, there's now an ongoing process of alienating more and more the Roma people.
Nationalism remains as a last exit, last solution, because we can always identify with those who speak the same language, look the same way as we do, and thus us against them works.
What's happening in Hungary today is best described as softcore ethnic cleansing.
Romas are living here for hundreds of years, literally, so it's not an exaggeration. They are members or had been members of the city's community. The 8th of May, the mayor has decided and declared that he's going to clear out the gypsy roads.
Why is there such dislike for the Romas?
Scapegoat, that's the word. I've seen you be looking for that word, scapegoat.
Under the fascism, 1944, Miskolc had 30 to 50% Jewish people. And the Nazis killed 90% of the Jewish people in Miskolc. And I think today the Romani people are the Jewish.
With the rise of neoliberalism and globalization, we have a new crisis on our hands. Certainly there is a new sort of disenchantment among the Europeans, one that is undermining the political process. Is it also undermining democracy? Is it cyclical? Is it reversible? When we come back. It was here in Austria that the European radical right first rose to prominence. It won 28% of the vote. I was living in Europe at the time, and I tell you, the continent was shaken. How could it be that an Islamophobic, xenophobic, racist party would win almost a third of the vote? Today, radical right-wing parties are rising in the polls throughout the continent. They're in the Netherlands, Sweden, Greece, and France.
That we want to stop the immigration from people from Islamic countries.
In England, the name of the right-wing populist party is UKIP, the United Kingdom Independence Party. Their program is to put a freeze on immigration, double the number of prison spaces, go to a flat tax, repeal the Human Rights Act, and to withdraw from the European Union. In the last election for the European Parliament, they got more votes than England's established parties, Labour and the Conservatives. We went to London looking for answers.
What they are, rather, is an indication of a more profound crisis where many, many people of different political persuasions are disillusioned with mainstream politicians. They feel increasingly distant from what now looks more and more like a political class, by which I mean not just elected politicians, but the journalists who are employed to cover politics, the think tanks that are there to provide the ideas for politicians. This class, as it appears, is remote from the rest of society, and it's a self-serving elite.
So how do we explain the rise of the new radical right?
What drives it first is the attack on the political class. And that appeal is strong,
so you think,
and
for
it's
a good...
growing. And so... the politicians haven't yet worked out how to respond to that.
What you're saying is that politics and politicians have become a curse in Europe.
Yeah, I mean,
this is what I was saying.
For so many. Oh, yeah, and there has never been a point in the history of stable modern democracies where the contempt for the political class is as great as it is now.
In retrospect, could we say that democracy fulfilled its promise in Europe?
No.
But the early signs looked good in the 90s, didn't they? I mean, you know, the expansion towards Eastern Europe.
It looked like, yeah, I mean, it looked like there was nothing standing in the way of democratic expansion.
Are you one of those who think that there is lower participation in the elections because people are happy and they don't care who rules them?
Well, it seems hard to imagine that the poor are all content and that the rich are extremely discontent, because if you look at voting patterns, it's the more marginalized you are, the less you vote.
You know, people used to go to the streets, now they go to the tweet.
I think it shows that you can tweet and that can be part of a moment, but deep change, structural change...
You have to go to the street.
You not only have to go to the street, you also have to have your own robust institutions to stand up to the institutions of the state. That hasn't changed. The revolution will not be tweeted, and it won't be tweeted.
Right. But do you see the movement to the street as also part and parcel of countries that have already been democratic, or is this something where people try to move towards democracy?
I mean, one of the differences now, even than 25 years ago, is there aren't any big alternatives being peddled in the West. There's just this sense that this system no longer works for the people. It's become closed, it's become narrow, elitist, oligarchic, whatever, technocratic.
I think that the last 35 years or so, at least, has seen what could almost be conceived of as a war on the human imagination. It's very, very difficult to mobilize people who essentially had it relentlessly thrust at them over and over again that nothing else is possible. Most people don't imagine that democracy in any real sense could really happen.
By any historical standards, we are super rich, we are super safe, we are super peaceful. So if you want to shake people's sense that they have to think outside of the box of that kind of stability and security, I think it takes real crisis situations.
You don't think 2008 was enough of a crisis
no,
to shake things up in
and
Europe?
I think partly because by technocratic standards, we're quite well governed, in the sense that the people in charge had a relatively clear idea of how to prevent the worst from happening. I don't think they have any idea about how to make the best happen.
When you're saying we're very well run and that...
We're
efficiently run, but we're efficiently run in a certain sense, in the sense of if the efficiency is aimed at reproducing the existing system.
Yeah.
We have continual growing inequality, continual decline in the sort of prospects and security of the bulk of the population.
And that's a result of neoliberals.
Absolutely, yes. Thus, they've created a situation where, well, the system in many ways is crumbling before our eyes, and no one can really imagine anything else.
I don't think it's crumbling before our eyes, but I do think there are long-term structural challenges. And I think the depressing lesson of history is to really affect that kind of structural change tends to take the kind of crisis which would dwarf what we've been through. The traditional way of doing it is war.
You're not suggesting we go out and kill out a few billions of
really
people?
No, that's the thing. I think we have to find a different way.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a really big challenge. I mean, there are other kinds of crises that might do it, but I think it's crazy to be confident that the structural change it would trigger would necessarily be for the best.
But let me tell you what is striking, again paradoxical, again in Europe, is just as that is in retreat, that notion of politics and democratic politics, the radical right and the radical left and everyone else in between would like to be called themselves Democrat.
Oh, everybody wants the term, yeah.
Everyone in the world likes to call themselves Democrats since 1989. It's a very fashionable thing. So you can be totally authoritarian, but you would call yourself freedom, democracy.
No, and I'm always suspicious when people on the far left and the far right find themselves speaking the same language. It speaks to a kind of deep frustration, but it doesn't speak to a coherent alternative.
I think that the reason that the far right is taking over is so much of that imaginative space is because of the utter complete failure of the sort of permissible institutional left to come up with any kind of imaginative vision whatsoever. The mainstream left has embraced bureaucracy and the market at the same time and has created this utterly unlovable fusion. The fact that anybody votes for these people is shocking in a way.
We also do compete with authoritarian China.
I mean, if this is the democracy autocracy question, I still believe that the fundamental difference is that democracies, that there's no guarantee that democracies will arrive at the solution to the problem of politics, because there is no solution, probably. But democracies are less likely to get stuck with the terminal mistakes. They make, democratic politicians make all sorts of mistakes. It's part of the reason that people do continue to vote.
Because in the end of the day, if what you're looking for is efficiency, and it's all about the economy and what's good for the economy.
I mean, the reason why the China model has any sort of appeal is they seem to actually be able to address structural crises. They have more mechanisms and levers to pull.
During the democratic crisis, the story spreads that the autocrats have this, you know, the strategic long-term advantage because they can think long-term and they can think decisively.
Maybe the reason is just because they were successful capitalist societies. Industrialized, advanced, you know, colonialized the world, benefited from cheap resources, had advanced industry, and that's why they are prosperous. Had nothing to do with liberal democracy.
Definitely helps, and again, because the sample size is so small, we
can't. But what you're suggesting is democracy is the reason for the success, when in fact it could have been exploiting the third world, it could have been having been quite, you know, a few years ahead of the rest, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, add something to your...
Okay, but let me just say one thing, because that's, you know, it's a serious charge, that it's like, I think... Yeah, that people who defend democracy are actually mistaking the success of democracy for simply exploitation over time.
And how could we discount that as part of their success?
Right.
Having access to cheap markets, to cheap goods, and so on. So the last 30 years, since we had that change in the mid-late 80s, who has been more efficient, more clever, more long-term, more strategic, Europeans or the Chinese?
Right, but I think there is currently a fashion out there, there's a phrase in academic discourse, adaptable authoritarianism.
I
don't believe that adaptable authoritarianism in the long run has the advantage.
I don't disagree with you. Okay. But what I'm saying is, if it's not social progress is at the heart of democracy, then the discussion about efficiency and the capacity to correct mistakes is beside the point.
Just by capitalist logic, any system works better when there is competition. When there was competition to capitalism, capitalism worked better. There was a will to redistribute it, and those democratic elements were allowed to flourish in a way that they haven't been since.
David's saying modeling, you're saying they're stuck in the mud of their own misbehavior.
But you're hearing signs of the adaptability.
This is the strategy that's going on here, too.
You think there's a room to reform?
I think
within
that insofar as we have any hope of politicians adopting any kind of visionary politics, it's going to happen by people essentially rejecting the political order and trying to organize outside it, which is what is happening.
And if any place has a chance for that, it should be Europe. I mean, there's a long tradition.
And that's the thought that slightly keeps me awake
at night. Scary thought. Anyway, thank you.
Thanks.
That's the present, legitimizing the authoritarians. Is that the future, or will we see a democratic revival? The next crisis, will it be big enough to create change or more muddling through?
Yeah. The good part was immediately evident. It was the fall of the Soviet Empire.
We must remember that behind the wall was a police state with forced labor camps, deportations, show trials, as well as monumental inefficiency. And yet, when the wall came down, cherry trees did not blossom in every yard. Generosity did not bloom in every heart.
I wish some of the better things from East Germany had remained after the fall of the wall. Then the West would be an even better place today.
Ich musste auch sagen, was es bedeutet für Menschen, die arbeitslos sind.
I had to address what it means for the unemployed, who simply couldn't afford to go home every week because they lived 800 kilometers away. That's love.
Dass sie ihren Liebsten.
Sharing peaceful attitude. All this is despised now. And a kind of cynical, egoistic, selfish ideology has replaced it.
When the war came down, we got the political freedom, the individual freedom. But then, after a while, the economic freedom was gone, because you really have a lot of pressure to finance your lifestyle, to having a nice life, and that was new for us.
Nowadays, we speak about what is best for the economy, as if the economy itself was not in the service of the people.
And everybody is thinking about the relation between democracy and capitalism and whether or not we are already in a refeudalized global system where some 10 million billionaires hold the world and screw the rest.
I believe that the major danger for now, for democracies now, comes from within.
Slavoj, it seems that there's a bit of a malaise in Western democracies.
The basic fact, I think, is that globally, today's capitalism, in order to function in a smooth way, not only no longer needs democracy, but even has to function actively in a non-democratic way, needing fast decisions and so on, secret agreements and so on and so on. The ideal form of today's capitalism is what? Lee Kuan Yew, the founding father of today's Singapore. His invention of Lee Kuan Yew is precisely what we wrongly call democracy with Asian values, which has nothing to do with Asian people, but simply means authoritarian democracy.
We are definitely in a world where multinational companies are the most powerful actors in the world. In some cases, they directly own their own governments, and in other cases, they just have decisive influence over them. It doesn't lead to solutions of poverty, environment, social inequality, so it's not a workable system.
You don't think economic freedom and political freedom come together?
I don't think that the majority of the people, this will sound horrible what I will say, they want the appearance that they decide, but secretly, discreetly, they want to be told how to decide.
You don't think reforming the political governance will
be... I'm not against doing it. I just doubt if in the long term this will work.
Nobody wants to think right now. Either it's slogans or it's all money. Our politicians are rated, actually. Oh, Hillary Clinton's great. She can raise lots of money. That should be terrifying for us, not satisfying. That means who's going to run her policies? Wall Street, is that what we want? That's not going to get us out of the trouble.
Is this a trend? Is this a phase?
Absolutely, it's a trend. And I think the choice is either some kind of reinvention of a more radical left, or we are all becoming Singapore, but not as well-functioning as Singapore. We are inside, and outside there are those poor that we don't even see.
But in illiberal democracies, and I've been to Russia, I've been to Hungary recently, there's also these fences between the rich and the poor.
Yeah, global phenomenon, that's the sad thing. I think that economically, today's global capitalism cannot afford universal democratic freedom in the old bourgeois sense.
So what you're saying is that the same bourgeois, the same capitalist mode of production that produced a certain working force, a certain middle class, that produced democracy, is now eroding democracy.
Yeah, that's my pessimist view, yes.
That's why democracy is in retreat and in crisis?
Yes, ultimately, yes. I think that Europe is in a deep, really, even deeper than other world crisis today.
Europe is in a bigger crisis than...
I was a year ago in South Korea, and I gave a talk and talked about crisis. They started to laugh at me. They told me, listen, Latin America is progressing. Even sub-Saharan Africa is progressing. We are exploding. Even United... They told me Western Europe is the only place which is really in crisis.
The EU doesn't have a long-term strategy. it's not surprising. The U.S. does not have a long-term strategy. Everybody improvises in this world right now, and our politicians are the worst of it. They're showmen who are standing for elections or juggling to maintain power.
There's a lot to safeguard. There's a lot to honor. Yeah. 25 years after the fall of the Berlin Wall, presumably this should have been a more universal idea.
Is there a third way for Europe, neither anti-immigrant Europe nor this abstract technocratic Europe, to reinvent itself? If not, then it will be very sad, because, you know, it's fashionable today to be anti-Eurocentric, but there are some good things in European history, the idea of tolerance, equality, and so on and so on. This is simply disappearing.
Are we really obliged to choose between the anarchy of ultra-liberalism and the totalitarian state?
The worldviews of Cvetan Todorov, Agnes Heller, and Slavoj Žižek grew beneath the shadow of the wall. But it's important to hear from people whose personal and collective memory does not include an iron curtain dividing the East from the West. So we visited the Central European University in Budapest.
For me as a Ukrainian, it's more important that an individual is respected and has rights.
So you're optimistic that Ukraine is going that way?
Yeah, I'm more optimistic that Ukraine is going towards the something that we call European values. And usually by European values in Ukraine, we mean human rights, we mean democracy.
Why is elections becoming lower and lower participations, I mean, in Europe? If it's such a great place, why are people participating less and less in elections?
Well, my reason, my personal reason why I usually don't participate in elections is when you read the different programs of these two biggest parties, you don't see the difference. So I don't know what to choose. And basically, I don't care. People are very passive about it today because...
People are what?
Passive.
Passive,
right. Passive about choosing new leaders because they don't see any change. So it's quite a depressing state, if you ask me.
The political parties, who do they represent then?
Well, not the people, I think. What happened, I can talk only for my country, after the war in Croatia, is basically the rich elite, through privatization, got the political influence as well.
I think it's a general problem. The larger the government grows, the more it's a tool for the wealthy people. And during elections, you basically have a beauty contest. In this kind of democracy, you basically vote for the slogan, for the idea.
You think, but that's hardly democracy. That sounds to me like...
That's sad.
But you think this is the reality?
Yeah. Democracy presupposes active participation of citizens. And if citizens do not participate, if they are passive, then there might be some danger of an authoritarian regime.
I think many people would actually be happy to have someone powerful who will get things together, you know, and make the whole country function.
Do you think it's attractive?
Exactly.
They want someone just to step in and say, this is how it is.
But if people vote for oligarchs, they will be disappointed soon. So sooner or later, they will understand that if this oligarch doesn't represent our interests, we will have to vote for someone else. You often forget about good sides of the European integration and living in Europe, like freedom of movement, working and traveling in Europe, studying in all over the European Union, wherever you want. I believe that the world has become a better place. Could you imagine that we have this discussion like 30, 40 years ago? So I think we should appreciate this change and see that there are some positive developments.
Are you optimistic about where things are going to go now in the Ukraine and Eastern Europe?
I am optimistic, and I'm actually optimistic about young people nowadays.
I think there are more opportunities.
I do agree that we have more opportunities, and it's for the generations that will come to see how we are going to use them.
Is it time for pessimism or optimism? More to the point, is it time to be passive, or is it time for activism? What will it take then to stop or to stem the tide and to protect democracy?
Neoliberalism wasn't there all over the place. It was organized by a group of people. It was supported by influential statesmen, stateswomen like Margaret Thatcher. This was the result of human action.
the loss of democracy to corporatocracy, the growing inequality, the hardening underclass that we have. There are solutions to this, but the solutions require political change.
Social forces, more Occupy movements, I don't know, more unions, more social, more political discussion.
Right, yeah.
Better journalism, I guess.
All of the above.
But you don't think neoliberalism is, by any, or Mises-ism is inevitable? It's not.
I'm sure it's not inevitable because it has arrived at a certain point of history, and with the same ease, it can disappear.
As an East German, I come from a dictatorship. I think my senses are very aware, very fresh, and so I'm a big fan of radical individual freedom. And I think this is the future. And if societies can adapt to the democratic system and guarantee people individual freedom, they will be successful. And if the society is not be able to do that, they will fail completely.
Basically, beating money with votes, that's what's needed, because money drives the system, but votes still could change the system.
The end of all these questions, it's a matter if we, the people, stand up or not, and if we speak out loud, and if we accept that or not. And being here, being in Berlin, this is, by the way, the story of the fall of the wall. People stood up. They said, stop. Tear down this wall. We want to be free. And they made it. And that's the lesson for me. If we want to, we can. And we should. This is not for the camera, this is for you. It depends on us. Don't let anybody fool yourself. Get after these guys in your country and tell them this is not the right way and stand up, and you see what's happening in Ferguson if people stand up.
Despite the criticism and disenchantment, I still find Europe to be an oasis of democracy, a bastion of human rights. Now, perhaps the continent is in decline. The problems and challenges are real. Seasons have changed. But I've been around the world, and I tell you, people pay with blood what Europeans have already. So Europeans have only themselves to blame, because all the means needed are at their disposal. The only thing they need to do is to act.